That's the only way. Welcome, everybody. This is Robert Allen McRae, and I love this blab today because this blab today is about happiness and success. And it has a unique twist to it today. So, that is about how, we've gone through all these trials and these tribulations that we've had in our lives. They're not really tribulations, they're learning experiences. And I like to welcome Stephen L. Whiteley. And you can also ask Stephen any question. The blab. Oh, look at this. We have Bob on the line. Hey, Bob.
Welcome,
Hey,
Bob.
Bob. So you can chat, you can jump on one of our panels here, have a question with us. Also, we can have any kind of topic that you want. I would love to see a challenge here that would put Steven in the hot seat. So hope Bob's here to do
I
that.
hope so too, because I love being in the hot seat because that means we all have a chance to learn.
Hey, beautiful as it is. Bob, can you hear us? Can you hear us, Bob? My first time on Blabber. Welcome. Welcome. Yoo-hoo!
Okay, we can hear your sound because we can hear your fingers tapping,
There you
so it's
go.
you not hearing us.
That's right. You have to find a way to turn on your turn up the volume so you can hear us. And I think that that would be a great opportunity. And then you can ask us questions because you're just hearing us. You're not hearing us. You are reading lips, Bob. If he listens to this replay afterwards, I'm going to say you're a Ripley, a ripper, a lip reader. So, very cool. And
If
awesome.
Bob, if you're using Chrome, go to the upper box where you type in the URL, click on the camera, and
Woo-hoo.
tell
Hey,
it to allow.
Scott. Welcome, Scott.
Hey, Nancy, I'm on this thing. I can't, how do you get the sound?
Oh, no, we can
Hey,
hear
we hear
you.
you! The camera.
All right. Okay.
We have the
William, did
dog
you see?
walking in from the doorway.
It's all starting to work.
Starting to work.
You're halfway there.
Everybody is starting to get.
Well, there's our old friend J.S. Gilbert.
Hey, Jess
Good
Gilbert.
to see you back.
Hey,
Marcos,
Scott.
welcome. Sunday Vidal, welcome. Happy to see everybody here. Yes.
Feedback, guys. We would like feedback how we can actually
Hey,
create
Gilbertism. There you
happiness
are.
and
There's Bob
success.
Gray. Welcome, Bob
Hey,
Gray.
Bob Gray.
All coming up.
I have
This is
sound. Bob, you're alive.
it. Yay, you can hear us.
Hey,
Yes.
you're alive.
Yep.
There we
And we
go.
can hear you. Yay!
Well, I gotta say, that is happiness and success. Being able to get on here for your
Exactly.
first time, Bob, and the way you did it was exceptional.
I had a helper here, so
Well, then you even gave credit to your helper. That is awesome. What a way to do it. It does, it is like that. It's more the way you can give. Very good. Good. Did your helper it did is there any benefits to having your helper?
I think so. There she is.
Hi.
Hi
There we
there. Good for
go.
you.
Now we thank you for
Yeah.
that. Thank you. So, Bob,
Okay.
what is your take on happiness and success?
Well, I was really attracted to the title because the some stages in my career that had been challenges. I wasn't, I wasn't the happiest person. So I just kind of wanted to tune in and blab and get a little insight into this.
Ah, good. Good. Well, Stephen, you got your work cut out then, because he's waiting for information.
Well, here's somebody.
Yes, good to see you.
Hey.
You guys always have smiles on your faces, I tell you.
Well, Gilbert, let me tell you what, you're a legend out here in the blab world.
Really? Oh, my goodness. I didn't know.
You are.
I had no idea. Okay.
Well, you are.
I think maybe I just spend too much time on here is really what it comes down to.
Well, I believe you add a lot of value. So happiness and success to you is, what does it mean?
I don't think that they're mutually connected necessarily. I think that we've been sucking at the teat of the gospel of prosperity for at least 2.5 decades strong. And that has a lot to do with some very distorted definitions of success. So that's kind of what I think. So success tends to be you're making all kinds of money and you can afford gold-plated faucets in your bathroom in your summer home. Mm-hmm. That's often what we look at with success. So yeah. And I've mentioned before, my kind of take on happiness is not elation, and it's not even a roller coaster. It's not a contrasty thing. It's sort of like happiness is the default state.
Nice. So, can you say more about that state? What kind of state that state is?
It sort of means that and again, realize there's a difference between being able to articulate things, mm-hmm. and have them in your mind and actually internalize them and live and breathe them. So yes, there's a great deal of difficulty I have between my knowing and my understanding. Let's just put it that way.
Well said.
Well said.
So what I try to do is I try to practice just getting up in the morning and being in a state of happiness without having to have external influences applied that would make me happy. So am I happy because I get to have a really good cup of coffee? Am I happy because I get to watch a television show that I want to watch? Am I happy? Or am I just happy because that's just the way it should be?
I like that because that aligns very well with what I'm experiencing. And I have a few words for it. Maybe you want to try them on.
Sure.
Okay. Imagine for a minute that you are truly loving everything about you. Doesn't matter what you perceive as flaws, but that you're truly loving everything about you, that you're thankful and grateful for everything and everybody around you, and that you're busily engaged in what is most meaningful to you.
Mm.
That is my definition of happiness.
Okay.
So I call it harmony. Harmony with three things: harmony with yourself, harmony with your environment, and harmony with your purpose for living. To me, that's happiness.
All righty. You know what? Some people like to get there in a train. Some people like to drive. Some people like the bus. Some people like the plane.
Yes.
So I've learned that. I think one of the beauties of life is the diversity of not just our colors and our religions and our beliefs and our cultures and the food that we eat, but what motivates us, what stimulates us, and how we transform that into action. So I'm trying to practice little things. Like, I don't say I disagree with you. I say my experiences are a little different.
I like to hear them now.
Yeah. Nice. So that's it. I don't I don't really have a great way of articulating it when it works.
You don't have to.
When it's working and I can just be okay with the moment, it's because I do realize that everything that I need, I have in this moment. And whatever happened before doesn't really matter, and I shouldn't be concerned that much about the next moment if I can truly be in this moment. It's very difficult stuff. It's not, and it's very hard in a Western society to put this kind of stuff into practice. But you know, we do the best we can and we try. And you know, I think, you know, there are times when you are being the best you can be, and maybe it's as simple as just being aware of when that's happening.
Nice. Well said.
Well said. My other question here would be, is some of your experiences on success, and you've had a lot of success.
I've been pretty lucky. I think it's been a combination of a couple of things. There is something to be said for being goals oriented, but then there's also something to be said for being aware of other things that may be happening around you. And can you take advantage of those? Are you capable? There's an interesting parable about flight. I don't know if you guys are aware of this. An airplane going from New York to Los Angeles is off course 95 to 97% of the time.
Mm-hmm.
It is not its ability to stay on course that allows it to get from one place to another, but simply its ability to know where it is at any given moment, understand where it needs to be going, and make that correction. So we see, again, the gospel of prosperity and this whole thing about passion and I'm passionate and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It acts as blinders frequently. We feel as though this is what our God wants us to do. This we were born to do this, and we have our sights fixed on it, and we may not realize that on this journey there are all kinds of other things we can contribute to and have contribute to us. So I think it's just really about being mindful and paying attention, more so than having this all encompassing passion that brings us, pushes us forward. You don't have clarity with passion.
Whoa. You don't have clarity with passion.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And I'm not talking about the passion of Christ. I'm talking about passion as most people see it.
Right. Because
Because I think there's a difference there. There's passion that arises on its own that drives action for an unknown reason, and there's no clarity.
Yeah.
And then there's also the passion that comes from clarity with meaning.
Exactly. Most people probably wouldn't describe the latter as passion. I found an interesting thing about people in life. I found that truly spiritual people never refer to themselves as spiritual. I found that very kind people never refer to themselves as kind. Benevolent people very rarely describe themselves as benevolent, and so on and so forth. So truly passionate people in the latter situation who have found that match and are really doing well. And I don't know a better way to describe it. They wouldn't say I'm following my passion or I'm a passionate person, but individuals, I think, who, I can't get a job. Nobody wants to hire me. I've always wanted to be a painter. And so they buy some paints and some canvases, and their passion now is to make a living as a painter. And I think that's a mistake. So that's that passion that drives you to do things without clarity versus having really gotten into a place where, you know, what you're doing has value to yourself in some fashion. It doesn't have to be monetary value. And you can really see that. you have that clarity. But nice. A lot of other people, you know, that saying about throwing good money after bad. If you're that airplane and you're constantly looking at where you are and trying to make corrections, you don't throw good money after bad. You realize when maybe it's time to pack up and try something else, and you work with a little more clarity.
Yeah, I used to be a pilot.
Okay.
And what I would say is there are no perfect pilots.
Yeah.
The best pilots just make smaller mistakes.
Wow.
The really good pilots are the ones that know where the mountains are.
Yeah, exactly. That make as many landings as takeoffs.
That's interesting. Wow.
So then again, I think we have to go back and we have to look at what the word success means. And, you know, does it fit Judeo-Christian patterns? Does it fit 21st century models in Western society? You know, where are we, you know, what are we looking at as far as this word success is concerned? So,
yeah. So that's exactly what I wanted to talk about today.
Okay.
What does success really mean?
So I go ahead, Stephen. I like that idea.
Yeah. Because I think exactly like you're saying, J.S.
I hope I didn't chase Bob out of the seat. Please, Bob.
We'd be happy to have you back, Bob. You can join us anytime.
Yeah. I mean, just these are just opinions that we all have. And there's no right or wrong or anything like that. We're all just walking around trying to be a little better. That's really it.
Trying to be better ourselves. And hopefully that will help others.
Thank you, Bob. He's still there. He didn't go anywhere. Oh,
okay.
Good.
Well, I'll tell you, I know you want to talk about a little bit success. One of the things that I found that's interesting and a model for success that I really, really enjoy now, success to me is being in a place where things are in a position where I can be of a great deal of service.
That is very close to what I'm talking
about. That's very powerful because that's what we're talking about. It's really in alignment.
Yeah, exactly. Because, you know, what I was thinking is that a lot of people think of success as the outer trappings. And they think about it as what that they can get or what they can have. And to them, that means success. And I would see it as a bit the other way around, that really those, you know, it feels good to get something. It feels good to buy something, but not for very long.
No.
It's a very transient feeling. Whereas when we are really creating and developing and serving, then we have this deep feeling of satisfaction about us. And that is not only a lasting feeling, but it can give over and over again when we think back on that time. So the real thing about it is what can I produce, not what can I consume. And so when we can produce something that is meaningful to us and really meaningful to other people, then I believe that that is success, because what we're doing is helping ourselves and helping others to give more to our world. And this is the happy way of being, in my view, because when we are happy, we are at a higher vibrational level. And at those higher vibrational levels, we have higher levels of creativity, productivity, intuition, and normally connectivity. So what that allows us to do is to be more productive in our ability of what we produce, how much of it we produce, and how we can bring it out to the people that want it and need it. So by being at a happier level, we actually improve our ability to help our world And this, I believe, is the highest definition of success. So I don't know if that works for everybody out there, but it's certainly working for me. And I think it has wide acceptance among those that have really experienced it. So I'm open to any questions or comments or anything that anybody wants to say about that. I think that often we get it backwards.
I think I heard a little power versus power versus there.
A power what?
Power versus force.
Oh, power versus force.
Are you familiar with that book?
I am familiar with that book. Absolutely. You're absolutely right.
I thought I heard a little bit of that in that explanation. I enjoyed that.
Raising the vibrational level is power versus force. Yeah. Absolutely. Mm. And I just find that you probably don't know that, JS, but in my own little mind, I have ended unhappiness for good. So now more than 7.5 years with no anger, no stress, no frustration. Wow. And what I have found is that that is really promoting everything that I really want in my way of living, you know, whether it be health or fitness or sleeping or relationships or achievement or any of those kind of things.
I still struggle on several levels with the fact that maybe there are aspects of me that don't want to be as healthy as I can be or as happy as I can be. And I think this is the case with a lot of people. It's, so, you know, to a large extent, I'm happy for whatever strides I'm capable of making. And I hope that, that I get the willingness to make greater strides, tomorrow or in the future. But, you know, the big thing, I think the first step, you hear a lot of people say, oh, you have to love yourself. And I think for a lot of us, the first step really is quit hating yourself. So that's a place where I came from. And I've had problems with substance abuse and things like that. So 30 years without drugs and 29 years without drinking and 15 years without smoking and lots of other stuff. So, you know, it's very much still in the process of getting to the point where I'm not hating myself and not blaming others. Yes. Yeah.
Well, I think that is actually the challenge of living. The main challenge of living, I believe, is learning to love ourselves. And all of those behaviors that are self-destructive, and I had my share of them as well. I know exactly what you're talking about. All of those behaviors are self-destructive, are evidence of us not loving ourselves. And so I think that journey of learning to love ourselves is the journey of living. And that's the journey that I'm on and that I love to help other people get.
So did you go through processes where it was very much baby steps and learning to not hate yourself, right? So, okay.
Yeah, that's exactly right. You know, for a long time, I was, well, at the depth of my self-hate, I was 25 pounds heavier and I was soft and weak and I was in pain.
Yeah.
At that point, you know, I was drinking a lot and eating a lot of sugar and I've had my years of smoking as well. Never been really big on drugs. I did a little bit of that when I was young, but didn't really like it. So, and then a lot of just avoidance, hiding, right? And so all of these things are self-destructive behavior.
And
I had to let that go bit by bit. I have learned ways of doing it, what I call wholesale instead of retail. So I don't have to do it all, you know, one incident at a time. Mm-hmm. But it has certainly been a gradual journey. And I didn't set out to end unhappiness for good. That was not my aim. My aim was to get happy again. And it was only looking backwards that I realized, oh, my God, it's been 4 years since I've been unhappy.
And do you find that being in service is just a sort of a natural state for you? Or do you still, is it something you need to be mindful of or you work towards? Or
it's something I had to learn. Now it's a natural state, but it wasn't, before I was living in drudgery. Hmm. You know, I was feeling imposed.
What a great word.
Yes. So I was resentful of all of the responsibilities that I was asked to put on, but not anymore. I just love when I'm challenged to give more, because what it means is I'm learning to be more helpful and more productive, and that makes me feel better about me.
And Robert,
because I will do it in a way that I continue loving me. I won't do it in a way that causes me to stop giving myself proper nutrition and exercise and meditation and sleep. But I will find ways to get things done.
Well, and getting back to the airplane metaphor, you know, they do say put your oxygen mask on before you help others. So,
and I'm very big on that.
Yeah. And what about you, Robert? Where are you at today?
I am in the process of going through, and I'm feeling you, and I can resonate with what you're saying. And the understanding of loving and dropping the hate, and fortunately I'm lucky that I don't have the addictions. I have gone through my addictions. Okay. Yeah. And I spent 7 years in yoga. So, but you have that residue about who you are and what you've done in the past and all the guilt around how you've raised your children and family. And you need to know that I personally need to know that I need to let that go and start not getting down on myself and start loving myself through that process.
So I was going to say, on a scale of 1 to 10, 10, yeah, I agree with that. And 1, I have trouble. Where would you be at with the statement, it's okay for me to be a flawed human being?
I'm okay. I'm at a 9 and 9.5 on that.
Yeah, one. No, I go from like 2 to 7. It bounces back and forth.
Yeah, but I'm about a 9. And well, that 1% gets you in the ass.
I guess that's true. Yeah.
You know, it comes on, and it comes on really quick, and also it comes off really quick. So as it's because it happens for me. And it truly does. And I know the as soon as it does, whoa, I got to shift that inside of me now. So, and like getting, you know, even these blabs and being on and exposed, that is a risk. So knowing that is
on and not being exposed is a risk too.
Yes, exactly. Yes. That's a good point. Because I'm hiding.
I think avoidance is a higher risk than engagement.
Yeah. And the thing is, that's nice about blab. For me, I often make a lot of excuses. I live in a neighborhood where there are very few people that actually speak English as a first language. I don't know my neighbors, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. So you can make all kinds of excuses for isolation. And then this internet comes along, and oddly enough, my 3 closest friends that I have right now are all individuals I met online. Yeah, one I've known for 9 years, one for 7 years, and the other for 5. So,
my gosh.
Yeah. It's amazing. Hey?
It is pretty incredible. It's
a gift.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, so some people look at it and, you know, it's like anything. I was talking about, forget who was it you or saying about, or was it Steven, somebody yesterday, I think it was, or the day before, I can't remember who it was now, but said, is there like, oh, no, it was Dr. Curran. Do you know Dr.? Yeah, Dr. Curran. And he said, is there this one principle, you know, one deep abiding principle that to you is just so far? And I said, yeah, I said, you know, I really do try to embrace the truth that life is not fair. because I think that the root of unhappiness for a lot of people is trying to make sense of everything and make all situations fair or try to explain them. And, you know, life isn't fair. If it rains, one guy is, oh, great, my crops and my my reservoir is being full. And then the guy down the road is like, my livestock is drowning and my, you know, it's like that. So it was, I actually was saying it's fairness is always subjective. And then somebody in the chat room was trying to, I don't know, pick an argument with me. And he said, well, you can't say that, you know, the plight of the African-American in the United States is subjectively unfair. It's objectively unfair. And I said, well, go talk to a KKK member and see what they think. You know,
exactly.
Which is, you know, so you could sit here and Kurt Vonnegut called the existential hum, you know, where there's just so much noise. There's just so many things going on. And often you can't enjoy yourself because how can I enjoy the steak sandwich if there are people starving in Africa or whatever it is? And you really have to embrace the fact that life is not fair. You do what you can do, but life is not fair.
Yeah, no, fairness is certainly something that you can just give up on. And something that I've really become fond of is what I call divine order. So seeing everything that happens for its potential good and just looking for how it shows up.
So are you equating fairness with divine order?
No. No, I'm not the least bit interested in fairness, actually. I'm really interested in divine order because I see that everything is kind of aligned with the higher good. And if you look at it that way and you look for that aspect and act on it when your opportunities show up, then it all seems to work that way. So I just love this idea.
Could you give me that example? Could you give me an example, Stephen?
Yeah, sure. I would give you some examples.
Okay.
First of all, I want to give you an example of a story of what most people would call success, where it actually imploded on itself. And I heard this story from Darren Hardy. He said that close to where he lives, there was a restaurant that started up, and it was right on the beach and overlooking the water, and that it was really nicely appointed. And when it opened up with a big fanfare, they went down and it was really good. The staff were really friendly, really attentive, really professional. The food was excellent and fairly priced, and it came at good timing. The pairings were good. And the whole experience was really outstanding. So they said, hey, let's go back there regularly. So they started going back once a week or once every couple of weeks. And sure enough, telling all their friends about it, and everybody was doing that. And it got busier and busier. And it wasn't long before the lineups were outside the door. And it wasn't long after that before you had to wait an hour before you got in. But it was so great that everybody was more than happy to do that. But then over time, as it got busier and busier, the standards started to go down. And so the food wasn't always consistently great. And then the staff were getting a little bit sloppy and abrupt. And the experience was diminishing as they were rushing people a little bit. And so it wasn't long after that, about 6 months, that people started going, well, it's not so special. And the lineups dwindled, and then they didn't have enough to keep going. And about 6 months later, they closed. So happiness was not what they got.
Yeah.
And success was not what they got. It was what they were giving. And when they changed what they were giving, then so did their results change.
I see this happening. I work in advertising, and I see this happening with businesses all the time. You have a core group of people that really love working together and love coming together to create. And they, you know, they whether they have $5 in their pocket or wherever they are, they seem to be okay with it because they're in this process of being able to be creative and express themselves and work towards creating something that's greater than the sum of the parts. And then they will find an advertising agency, and maybe I'm involved, and they, oh yeah, we want to really project ourselves differently, and they work diligently to try and really be not just engaging, but to be fascinating and to be really close with their core client group. And then they work themselves up and they get to a point where they have a board of directors and they have stockholders and everybody else. And now they've all got big houses and wives and kids, and they're afraid. They're afraid to lose what they have. So everything that they've done that goes towards that success, all of that collaborating and all those good feelings and the edginess and all that kind of stuff, they're now afraid to lose all of that. And so they don't take chances and they don't take risks. And then suddenly they just become mundane and somebody else comes along and now they're a young, exciting company and they're offering.
Yeah. They're getting diminished.
So you have to marvel at companies like IBM that have managed to stay relevant and more than just relevant since 1914.
That's wild. Now, how do you perceive that?
Again, I think, all the kinds of things that we say that work for us, listening, the plane analogy, understanding where you are and where you need to make corrections, realizing that the people that have been listening to you are no longer the people that are listening to you. They're different. They have different sets of priorities. Just constantly being willing to take chances but yet at the same time, holding on to that core essence that is respected. And so it just seems to me that, there are certain companies out there that are able to do it better than others. And I constantly marvel at Sony owned the personal entertainment world, right? The Sony Walkman and everything. And then how did Apple computers, not Apple Entertainment, but Apple computers come along and create the iPod and iPhone. How did they topple Sony from the top of the pyramid?
Yeah,
I would say, wouldn't it be Steve Jobs' vision of having ease? It was just a vision that he had, that he believed that we could hold in our hands a phone that we could communicate and do everything with. And then he was able to leverage himself to make that happen. And
along with some really clever marketing.
Well, yeah.
With some clever marketing.
Yeah, but I think when you see what really works for an Apple computer, there's somebody who's really taking joy at some level in what they're doing. And then where it doesn't work, it's when the joy has been sucked out. And then it works again because the joy is put back in, and then it gets
exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I suspect that Apple wasn't thinking about Sony when they were developing their work. They were just thinking, how can we make this better for Joe and Jane out there in the public? And when they did that, they really worked to make it the best experience and to promote it in a way that was really meaningful to their intended audience.
So we go back to what I was saying, where you kind of agreed with me that we're at our best when we're in service. And these corporations, when they're focused on being in service, they seem to be at their best.
Yeah, and I think that's true for everybody. When they go at it with the attitude of joyful service. You can be in service, like I talked about my previous experience, where I was in drudgery. I was serving, yes, but my productivity since getting happy more often is really tripled what it was at that time. So it's amazing what we can produce when we raise our happiness energy.
So do you think Apple still has the opportunity to bring that same level of happiness as the time frame as Steve Jobs?
I think all businesses do. I think all entities do. I think it's definitely there. You know, whether or not they take advantage of it or whether or not it's defined is another thing. So, you know, just as I said, I struggle at many times with self-loathing. I wonder if there are companies out there that are just kind of going through that process as well.
Oh, I am sure that is the case because, you know, both emotions and habits are contagious. And so if at the top, they're unhappy with what's going on because they're unhappy with themselves, then that trickles down through the organization.
Yeah. Hi, Daphne. How are you?
Hello, gentlemen. Hello, hello. I live my life boldly. So I say, I'm going to step up with these three men.
Yeah.
And we're so glad
bold, girl. So what is success?
Oh, my gosh. I'm sitting here and I say, oh, I have my Saturday garb on and my Saturday face, but I'm stepping up no matter what.
That's the way to be. Put yourself out there. I'm all for that.
Yes. This is what it's all about. I heard two powerful words. I heard success. Oh no, more than two. I heard service, and I heard happiness. I said, "Ooh, I'm jumping in here. It's right up my alley."
So what's your take on it?
So what does it mean to you, my sweet dear?
Whatever you want to talk about.
Both. Now, happiness. Whatever, yeah, happiness and success.
Happiness to me is an inside job. So you can't look for anyone to make you happy. It is something you create and cultivate from the inside out. And it is sad that in our environment, you need to send me an autograph copy, Stephen, for being so bold. Yeah, it's extremely sad that in our world today, people go around and they say, you don't make me happy, you don't make me happy, you don't make me happy. And you find this in a lot of couples. You know, the lady always say, oh, he used to make me so happy. And I said, you know something? It's not somebody's responsibility to make you happy, but that is something that you need to do from the inside out. And by so doing, if the people in your surrounding happens to connect with that part of you, then you are both going to evolve together. Yeah. Success to me have different meanings. And I oftentimes ask people to define it for me. And
wow,
each
what do you mean by that?
Of us will define our success and successes differently. Success to me is a combination of my spirituality, my morals, my values, my health, and how much difference am I making in this world, and how am I impacting the lives of others?
Nice.
And by so doing, this success will eventually lead me into my wealth. Because so long as I keep these things in priority, the universe will compensate me royally for all that I'm doing. But what I have found out over the years is that many people, when you get into this conversation with them, they are so perturbed that they cannot pay their bills. They don't have a proper car. They don't live in a better house and all of that. I said, but that has nothing to do with success. You are confusing your success with wealth.
I would I would suggest that it's not even wealth, that it's just money.
Money, money, just another energy. Yes, yes. So that's my little 2 cents there.
Well, that's a pretty big 2 cents worth, I'm thinking.
Thank you.
Wow,
thank
that
you,
was
Robert.
Insightful.
Very
thank
nice you. Job, Daphne. Thank I you. Like what you had to say there.
Thank you. And
I would, one of the things that I talk about in terms of change, whether it's about trying to get rid of bad habits or things like that, is often considered the 4 stages of learning. Mm-hmm. The conscious, unconsciously incompetent, consciously incompetent, consciously competent, and unconsciously competent. So in the first stage, we don't even know what it is that we don't know. And so
yes,
it's very
yes,
difficult at that point to try and really, we're very impatient. We want to be better and we want to be better now. And
microwave results. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, exactly. And realistically what happens is that we're all individuals and we're different. We don't all respond to medicine the same way.
That's
we
right.
don't all respond to life in the same way.
That's
and
right.
this is a point at which we need to go through discovery and literally learn what it is about ourselves. So when everybody out there was saying, oh, JS, you need to learn to love yourself. I realized at that point, no, I need to stop hating myself first.
It's, yes.
If I'd have kept on going on that track of learning to love myself, it would have been futile, absolutely futile.
Yes.
Because there's a lot of work that has to be done before you can get to a point where you start learning to love yourself. And I'm not even there yet.
Amazing.
Not even.
Amazing. But, you know, personal love and self-development and growth is a continuous thing. We never arrive. We never arrive. And I love to use this scenario. I tell people, you must keep your cup running over continuously. And then as we go around serving, we are serving from our saucer and not depleting our cup. Because
well,
when you do this,
your emotional cup, I assume.
Yes, both your emotional cup and your spiritual cup. Because when you keep giving from your full cup and there's no overflowing, you become depressed, you become depleted, you become stressed out. But,
yes.
you know, because you keep pouring, you keep pouring, you keep pouring. And when you're empty, you have nothing to give. This is why it is so powerful to concentrate on the inner work in all of us, because we go around and we are serving, we are husbands, we are mothers, sisters, leaders, and we are empty inside.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We cannot give what we do not have.
You do look like Scott Bakula. That is for sure. I thought that when I first saw you, but I didn't want to say anything. Look at that picture. Does that look like Robert?
You talking about me?
No, Robert. Look at his side. I'm sorry, I'm interrupting you.
What is he? I don't know. What is he talking about?
Look at this picture on the side. Look at this picture on the side.
Oh, the guy on the TV. Oh, I'm so confused.
Does Robert look like him? I'm sorry.
Oh, Lord, help us. Oh, Lord, I don't know what you all got me into here. Oh,
no.
that is too funny.
Here's an interesting thing, though, getting back to
that
the 4 stages of learning. So
I hope I was able to add a little value.
You're great. Don't leave. Stay.
You did.
Okay.
You did, my dear.
Okay.
Yeah, we want
you class
here.
Up
we
the
want
joint.
You here.
Yeah.
You
do. I'm working for that autograph book. I'm telling you, I'm working hard. on a serious note, Stephen, I need to have you on my radio show to talk about that book. So again,
we need
to connect and talk about that.
Okay, so look in the chat box. I put my connection details there.
Oh, don't I have to scroll to find it? Oh.
It's not that hard for a person of service. So
I'm so glad I came in here because I didn't see you guys laughing before I turn up. So
no.
I brought some joy into what this room. Yeah. Huh?
here's an interesting something that I observation then again about, you know, a personal journey in the four stages of learning. I think where most people are is in the third stage, or not most, but that's maybe where we get to and we stop. And that's, you know, as long as I'm constantly paying attention to what I need to be doing and what's going on and everything, I can then see results. But now there's that fourth thing where you just intuitively know what's going on. And I guess Stephen sort of seems to be at that place. Is that?
Well, thank you. Thank you very much, JS. But just so for everybody knows out there, a little tip from my perspective, the main reason people don't actually stay at conscious competence, but back into their own way of doing is because they tell themselves, I've got it. And if you avoid saying that and instead say, I'm so grateful for these gains, then you stay on that continuously building and improving path,
right,
instead of short-circuiting your subconscious cooperation and losing the gains you already made.
Yeah, but I would say that there's a couple of things in my life where I would say I've become unconsciously competent at, and it was sort of, I didn't realize that until somebody asked me to explain process. And then I realized process now is intuitive. Process is deep within me. And it was very difficult, where at one time I could tell you exactly how I went about doing that. I know now I would grasp at it, and I had to kind of really go backwards. And it was so that became the challenge, to say, well, for me, so I would imagine at this point, process, you and process have sort of become one.
Yes, well, that's a part of it. And the other part of it is that I have trained myself, and maybe that is a part of my process, to be very conscious anytime something that comes at me makes me feel less than happy.
Ah.
So that I immediately stop what I'm doing and I step back and I go, what happened there? How did I attract that to me? What is the higher truth of that? And what can I do to prevent that in the future? And I work to heal that in me. And then the other thing I do is this little tool right here. I wear this all the time, and
it's
count my happiness. It's just a counter.
Oh.
So I wear it time, and I count my happy moments.
Wow.
And so it's training my brain to focus on the positive and the simple joys that are all available.
Is this part of what you call neuroplasticity?
Yes, it is. Exactly.
Wow.
I've been wearing this thing now for about 2.5 years.
Okay.
When I started, I was getting about 35 clicks a day. And I thought, you know, for a happiness guy, that's not too bad. 35 happy moments in a day. But over time, it started to go up. And my average, I calculated it this morning, is over 465.
Wow.
A day now.
Wow.
It just keeps going up and up.
See, and the way I look at it, if I get up in the morning and I look in the newspaper and my name's not in the obituaries, happy day.
Well, that's another way I keep myself happy, is I don't read the newspaper.
What about you, Robert? Do you have would you say you're a happy person, Robert, or is it work for you to be happy, or
what works? I would have to say I have a tad bit of work that I continuously do. Through meditation, I do a lot of meditation, and I do a lot of
subliminals,
reprogramming, like reprogramming my mind. I have a lot.
Oh, there's that neural plasticity coming.
Yes, I do use probably close to an hour and a half.
The neuroplasticity is working, whether we think it is or not.
So that's positive. Positive. What do you call it? You just say you, a lot of that is just positive reinforcement or positive
reinforcement because of like you waking up. And if I didn't look, I don't look at the news. Yeah, I know. But I mean, that was a great example, by the way. But I mean, it's where I'm going.
Lord, it was.
You know, but the thing here is, it is just our thoughts that say to us at any given point, this is not a happy day. You can't be happy in this moment. You can't be happy in 5 moments from now. It's just our thoughts that are doing that.
Yeah. But, and you know, what's important is you are not your thoughts.
Yeah.
That's right.
You can be the observer of those thoughts. And taking that stance is so freeing. Be the observer of your thoughts, not the owner, not the identity.
Absolutely. So, I mean, in advertising, Gilbert, what have you found that really has made you happy in that successful moment in advertising? Is there a moment in your time frame in doing that type of business that really drew you out to stand out more than others?
There's not single moments really. I've had there are a lot of friends, a lot of parallels or whatever, who are maybe more influential, maybe they have more money, maybe whatever. But there are a lot of times where I've had decisions. I can go in this direction that might bring more money, or I can go in this direction which might bring more self-discovery. A lot of times they are mutually exclusive. Einstein is the one that said there is no correlation between a person's intelligence and their income earning capacity. So there are times where you say, I can either invest in making more money or I can invest in education. I love people. So to be able to sit down and talk to somebody and learn who they are and who their culture is and so on and so forth. I mean, to me, that just is, I don't know why, it's so nurturing. I enjoy that. That's better than going out and spending $500 buying clothes, or making the money. So there was a time where I would say I was resentful because I saw peers that were getting above the ladder and all that kind of stuff. But being able to look back with better perspective and understanding of what my journey has been like allows me in hindsight to say there was a lot of happiness there. I could have sucked up like crazy at the time had I only realized and that's, so we learn from our mistakes, and I try to be as happy as I can now with the decisions that I make. Hey, Marcus, how are you? Marcus is another guy. You know, I met him and a lot of other people that are, they work in this industry called Traffic Exchange. I have nothing to do with it. I don't really care to have anything to do with it or whatever, but, I visit with them on here and we chat about stuff like this too. As a great community, talk about all kinds of things, and they're great. They it's just a wonderful. I'm an expert in tease traffic exchanges. Yeah, I know nothing about them. it's got to do with the internet and traffic exchanges and their ways that people can make money by. It's not tons of money. It's like pennies at a time, but essentially by supporting products and services and things through traffic. When they say traffic, it's clicks and people. So yeah. Paid to click is part of it. Yeah. But we don't talk about that when I'm with them. We talk about things like, you know, health and humility and being good to one another. They have a great community. There's a 15th campaign now that they're doing for fresh water. They're bringing fresh water to impoverished areas, in Africa and India and Asia and so forth. I mean, it's lovely when you when people seem to be at their best naturally. There's no airs. His friends or whatever, they are who they are. You know, they have their frailties, they have their issues, they have their problems, they have their struggles, but they have no problem with happiness.
Yeah, exactly. When people work together, then there is happiness and productivity. When people are competing or fighting, there is less of that and less success.
Wow. Well, the success still has, you're still in competition. We always think that we're against someone else. In reality, it's the inside job that we're fighting against.
Well, Marcus was saying he wanted to sit down, so I'll just say one more thing and then I'll give him my seat. But Robert Scoble, who's
she jumped off. Okay,
he was giving Marcus a turn.
Thank you, Daphne.
Thank you.
Thank you, Daphne. I don't think Robert Scoble is somebody that necessarily people think of as being a spiritual individual or a lot of other things about him. He's sort of a technology evangelist, and he's well known on Periscope and other places around here. But he had a funny story about when he was younger and he worked at a camera store, and people would come into the camera store and they'd want to buy something like a camera. And he would say, you know, our competitors over at blah, blah, blah are selling it for a lot cheaper than I can sell it to you for. And he said what he did was he would lose a sale, but he would make a customer. And, I think that to a large extent, from getting to know Marcus and getting to know John and some of the other people in that community, that's sort of how you guys think, Marcus. I mean, seriously, you're like, if I can be of service to somebody, if they can benefit from what I can offer them, great. And if not, maybe Ken can, or maybe he can, or, you know, you try to find out about people and really it's about doing what's best for them, which may actually ultimately cost you a few bucks.
Yeah. But this is the idea that
he's like shaking his head.
Well, I was like, well, Stefan, sorry.
No, it's quite all right. But what I have to say is very short. But when we operate from a sense of lack, we see our other people in our environment as sharing a piece of pie, you know, and if I cut my slice bigger, your slice gets smaller. But I think what's actually happening is when there are a group of us in a single marketplace, then we're gardeners. We're growing a garden. And the more of us get in there growing and weeding and fertilizing, then the bigger the whole garden gets, and the more everybody produces, and the more everybody sells. So this is the idea of shifting from the mindset of competitiveness to the mindset of collaboration and abundance.
Yeah, it's right on, Stefan. I agree with you on that, and I think JS was in the same dimension on that as well. And I wanted to add more to what JS was saying at the end. You know, he was talking about like it might cost somebody a little bit of money when they go and help somebody else, but remember, I mean, that favor may be returned or may be returned by somebody else, and when it's a sharing process in a community, right?
Yeah.
And then, you know, I got to throw this classic quote in. Everybody knows this quote from, I forget his name. You guys will probably even remember, you know, success is helping, you know, if you help enough people get where they want to go, then you'll get where you want to go, you know, Ziegler or something, or
Zig Ziglar.
Zig Ziglar. Yeah.
Yeah.
There you That's go.
True, everything you want if you can help enough people get what they want.
Well, and here's an interesting thing as far as I'm concerned. I was noticing that a lot of the influencers a few years ago, who were they turning to influence them? And so I'm friends with a lot of them, and it's kind of fun to be in a position where, you know, we're ultimately people, you know, you may be on the food chain and you're here and they're there. But the fact is that some of the smartest people out there are willing to learn from whomever seems to make sense. It doesn't really matter where you are on that chain. And I found that that a lot of influencers, a lot of, you know, big shots, if you will, that are very successful are just open to any source that's going to improve them, make them better. Which is kind of how you can tell them apart from the phony balonies.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Hey, Marcus, can you tell us what your sense is of the link between happiness and success? And if you have a take on either one of those individually and what they are, we'd love to hear that too.
Well, my gosh. It sounds like kind of a deep question, but gosh.
Well, I saw that little girl, and I would say that's happiness and success right there.
Oh, yes. And yeah, thanks for JS. I mean, because that kind of reminds me. I mean, you know, happiness, as long as you're taking care of yourself, you know, like health and safety and stuff, it's, you know, many times, and also for me, friends and family can, you know, enrich your life. And I think most people, if they think deeply, would see it that way, that's kind of a part of happiness, you know. Also, okay, mm-hmm. That being said, that's funny what Ken said. But, you know, oh, gosh, I kind of had my train of thought.
See what you did, Ken?
Yeah, it comes back.
We're trying to, get Marcus ready for prime time here. And look what you did, Ken.
Okay. I was also going to add that, you know, but also if you're making a goal for yourself for making success, then, you know, as you start achieving that goal or achieving it, I think that's also a part of happiness as well. You know.
Yeah.
So you're in the process of the goal is the happiness part of the success. So you got to enjoy the journey of what you're doing.
Pursuing it and completing it. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. Satisfaction and excitement and really just creativity in action.
Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah, it's like some people, and I think it almost resonates for me a little bit, is that it's almost like the process of building something seems to make me happy.
And Art Jones reminds us of Maslow's hierarchy of needs. I forget what it is, but I know the top of the pyramid is supposed to be self-actualization.
Yeah, man. Let's see.
It's like clothing, shelter, safety, something or other.
Yeah, you got it. So basic needs, safety, belonging, self-esteem, self-actualization.
Yes.
Wow. Good job. Yeah.
You're done.
You know, the reason I got that is because I had a lot of psychology in my college major. Or I could have taken it at JS as well, like, with a little piece of comedy. I could have been like, oh, yeah, I know that. That's common knowledge. You know.
Thank you, Mark. Yeah, it is. And again, you know, getting back to that whole thing about unfair before, where Art unfortunately walked in when I chose that KKK reference, which was horrible.
Oh my God.
but that was the reason for it, because it was so dramatic.
Yeah.
But here's the thing that's interesting. When you look at, you know, unfair, do you know that the homeless in the United States live better than 2/3 of the rest of this planet?
Oh, my God.
Very good statistic.
So I didn't know that.
You know, the way you can look at that is you can say, wow, I didn't realize the homeless lived so well. Or you can say, it's terrible the way that the rest of the world lives.
How is the rest of the world living? That's awful.
I don't know. Again, when you say better, it's a subjective term, I think, that refers to, you know, food, clothing, shelter, basic needs, or Maslow's hierarchy. I wonder how many people get to self-actualization, how many people. It's funny because I remember that back in the day when we used to go through Est, and then Stuart Emery had actualizations. If that was another program, that's where I get that airplane analogy from, actually, from actualizations.
Yeah,
the homeless have easy access to clean drinking water, which is a big deal. And Marcus's groups are working with the fresh water.
John Olson's heavily involved, and gosh, I don't know how to really call that. It's like, but yeah, he believes that fresh drinking water is very important. I think it's third world countries in Africa. Yeah, he's into that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's a really pretty incredible thing. And what's going on now with Bill Gates working on, you know, desalinization programs, and he's got that huge machine that turns urine into drinking water. I mean, it's pretty amazing.
Wow.
Yeah, and he's like the first person to drink the water, which is great. I mean,
that's the way it has to work.
Yeah.
Let me test it first.
charitywater.org.
You use it.
see how good of a job I did, you know.
Yeah.
That's the organization, isn't it? charitywater.org. I'm sure that's it.
I don't remember.
I can look it up real quick.
That URL says
charitywater.org.
So Marcus, can you tell me a little bit about what you are about?
Now, as far as my personality, character, or my business, or what?
If I like your personality, character, that would be a good start.
That's the one that they're supporting, Art. That's a charity water.
Okay. Yeah, you just tell me where you want to go with this. Like, what? I don't know. I was a tennis player in high school. I have a 6-year-old daughter.
What are you doing now that really juices your life and inspires you?
Okay, yeah, and I would honestly answer that as, you know, how I talked about pursuing a goal, and recently I think I realized how important that is to me. That it's important for me to have an idea and be building on it, I guess, to be moving forward. And you know, if that gives me the feeling that maybe I'm never complete, where I have to keep pursuing a goal, well, so be it. And I guess if that's part of my habits, you know, I also like to make my daughter happy. You know, I like to see her smile. And I'm, you know, one of the things about me is I was in the Midwest, and then I kind of worked up a business, and I was able then to come where she was at, because she was with her mother in Washington State.
Wow. Yeah. So that pursuing of that goal, do you mind saying what that goal is?
Oh, it's just, that's just my business. We're into like website traffic and stuff. And, you know, all three of us worked really hard at it. I have like two other business partners, and, you know, a big part of my goal is I needed to make something work, and and part of my, you know, driving motivation was to be close to my daughter. I think that was something that could complete my life, you know.
That's awesome.
Nice. Yes.
Awesome.
Very awesome. Social connection.
That's like, you know, and I like that a lot too. The whole networking aspect, I like bringing people together, like a facilitator. I mean, not that I'm like super good at it, but I try, you know.
Don't we all?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. You got it.
Very good.
Yeah.
Cool. Daphne, did you have something you wanted to
say? Yeah, I came back on because I realized I could use this opportunity, if permitted, to speak about my nonprofit that I have in Jamaica, West Indies.
You are not only permitted, you are
included. You are.
Stefan, what did you say?
You are not only permitted to speak about your nonprofit, you are encouraged to speak about your nonprofit.
Okay, thank you, thank you, thank you. I am from the sunny island of Jamaica. And I was graduated from a little country school called Carmel Moravian School. When I was growing up there, there was no running water, no electricity. However, I am so proud of that community because that community began the molding of this amazing person that you are now listening to. So back in 2012, I went to Jamaica to visit my son. And my son now lives in one of the cities, and he had never gone to the rural section where I was born and raised. So one morning, I went to a church service, and when he came to pick me up, I was waiting outside, and the Spirit said to me, "You need to go to the country." That's what we call the rural section. So when he came, I said, "Let's gas up the car because I'm going to the country." And he was surprised because in the morning I did not mention anything about going to the country. And over 30 plus years, I had not gone to the country. So lots of new roads and everything. And I took one of the new roads and ended up at the section where I went to the farmer's market as a child. So we went from reverse into my district, and I'm showing him. I said, "This is where I came to the market as a child. That's where the police station was. That's where the post office was." And we continued. And then I got to where I used to live. And I said, right up that mountain was the trail that I walked to go home. And he stood in amazement. And he looked at me and he said, "Mommy, when I hear you speak about your humble beginnings, now I'm getting to understand it, because I did not understand." So we continue, and I got to my school building, and that little child just jumped out, and I started running down the steps, and there was a little building where the rich people back then, quote unquote, they own horses that they rode to church because nobody had cars back then, at least around where I live. And now that little shed where they used to put their horses while church was in service, they had now converted it to an early learning center. And I was excited. And I said to the teacher, "What happened to the tank that was here?" Because there was a cement structure that would collect the rainwater, and that's what we would use. And then she said, "Oh, ma'am, they built a new tank now." And I said, "I used to be a student here." And I told her who my father was. She said, "Oh, my God, you Miss Sweetie, Mas James' daughter?" I said, "Yes, ma'am," because she knew who my father was. So I went down the stairs, and the lady who was now the principal was a woman I knew when she was 3 years old. She was now the principal of the school. And the little kids saw me, and they start looking through the window, and I said, "Would you please call Miss Richards?" And she came out, and she said, she looked up and she said, "There is a God." And I did not know what this, I didn't know what the woman looked like since she became an adult. I said, "Gwen, is this you?" She said, "Yes, Miss Sweetie." She says, "Every day I pray that I see you before I die because I remember how kind you were to me as a little girl. As a little girl. And the tears. The tears ran out my eyes and I embraced her and we are both crying. Yeah. And then we let go and I said to her, Gwen, how is the school? She said, Miss Sweetie, some things are different and some is the same. Now the kids automatically go to high school. When I was there, you had to pass a special exams.
Oh, yeah.
Or if your parents could pay for you to go to high school. She said, now the kids go to school automatically. They have a choice of three high schools to go. But there's one problem. And right in the back of my head, the human part of me say, oh, these kids are smoking marijuana. That's what I thought. I thought.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't verbalize it. And then she says, Miss Sweetie, the kids are coming to school without breakfast. The minute, gentlemen, that she said that, I heard something inside of me said, that's why I sent you here today. And the tears started running down my face again, and I looked at her, I placed both my arms on her shoulder. I said, Gwen, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to make sure that these children get a hot breakfast 5 days a week.
Wow.
Nice. Nice.
And I came back and I created the Empowering People Foundation, Inc.
Nice.
And I said to myself, if everybody that I know would donate 25 cents, I would be able to provide the breakfast for the children. And it started out, and I got to $200 and something quick. And I started second guessing, and I called my coach and mentor in the Bahamas, Dr. Miles Monroe, and I was talking to Dr. Miles, and I said, Dr. Miles, this money is not coming in. He says, God would not call you to do something that he's not going to provide for.
Yes.
And I was driving down Route 7 in Connecticut one day, and the Spirit said to me, start where you are, the rest will come. I came home, I called the school up, I said, when is school starting in September? That's September 2014. And she told me, I said, I will be down to launch the breakfast program. At the time I called, I had $800 and something in the account. And by the time I was ready to go on that plane, we had $2,500. I went down there, and for the first 3 weeks, I was down there cooking breakfast alongside the parents.
Nice.
Not only that, I was saying, we know some Chinese people that had grocery stores, and I wanted to go speak with them that when the money's run out, if they could credit the school, the things so the kids don't go hungry. Then the teacher said to me, I have a different person for you to go and see, ma'am. She took me to a store up about 2 hours away.
Yeah.
And the lady said, the principal told me at church on Sunday what you were coming to do. And I want to know, ma'am, what I can do to help you. I said to her, well, listen, I have a little money here. I want to know if I could use it to start an account at your wholesale place. And you supply when the money run out. She says, no problem, ma'am. I gave her $900 and something US that she would hold in an account separate from the one from the school. And every Monday, she would give dry goods that they would use to provide the school. Then the principal is going to the market and buy the fresh fruits that they serve every day.
Yes.
And it has been such a blessing. The kids pay, those who have, they give $10 towards their breakfast, and that goes towards buying the fresh fruits. Well, one devastating thing happened approximately a month ago. Someone who was mentally ill touched the school, and it is totally burnt to the ground.
Oh my goodness.
At 2 o'clock in the morning, the principal texts me. I look and she says, "Mrs. Clark Hudson, this school is on fire." And I started crying because it is as if I have lost a limb and an arm. And then I cried, and I shook myself out. I said, no, this is just going to help us to come back stronger. Because apart, I had the program in three phases. One was to start the breakfast program. The second one was to build a cafeteria for them, because I'm going to be 68 years old, and the same little canteen that I ate out of is what they still have. Mm. And the third phase was to create an empowerment program where I work with the parents around here so that they can sustain and maintain what we created. So I'm just asking, we started a GoFundMe page. Mm-hmm. And I want to ask people to keep sending us energies, prayers, and everything, because I know that community will rise again. Nothing is going to stop us from, because when I came back and look over my journals over the years, I realized that I was journaling about things at the school without realizing that it had to do with the breakfast feeding program. So I know that I was called for this, and I'm not going to let any fire or anything stop me from that. So
nice.
Can I put the GoFundMe page in here or no?
Yes, by all means, put it in the chat box so everybody can see it. And when they come
yes.
to the replay, they can see it. And
yes,
it's a beautiful thing that you're doing.
Thank you.
I love it.
Thank you. It's Go.
That's a very inspiring story.
Thank you. Go fund.
So that makes you happy, GoFund. My dear.
Oh, extremely, extremely happy.
Yes, Go yes, fund. And all of us, as we're contributing, can feel great about the way we are in service and how that is helping us to serve a very needy and very appreciative community.
Yes,
a lot of kids happy.
Yes. So four. It's always great to be able to help out a worthy cause.
3, 8.
Yeah, that's quite the story. Where?
Yes, and you know, thank you, Marcus. You can look on that. And okay. When you click on that link, you will see the little canteen building. And you'll see we have pictures of the kids. The first day we launched it and everything, the kids are so happy. And it's just so amazing
nice.
To see.
Nice.
And I told the principal last week, I said, you know something? I'm praying. Because when they start to build the school, I know we're going to raise enough money to start building our cafeteria.
Good. Well, thank you very much, Daphne. And I have to say,
thank
you.
Sure
don't look 62 years old. So congratulations.
No, 68. I'll be 68 in December. I just told the whole world my age. But anyway, I'm proud.
Whatever you're doing, it's working. Be happy.
Thank you. Oh, yeah. Happy and laughter. Thank you so very much. I'll give my seat. I commend to Marcus on what you're doing.
Good. Okay. Well, so we're now a half hour over. So I think it's probably time to laugh out.
All right.
Just recap.
And Leigh, you have something to say, Marcus?
No, it sort of answers my question. I was going to ask what part of the world this is going down at, but I assume there's more information on the GoFundMe page. You know, another thing I was going to ask is what's the minimum amount of donation you can do to GoFundMe? Does anybody know?
I don't think there is a minimum.
Okay. It was like, because they accept PayPal, right? And then,
yep.
Yeah. You know, one thing cool that PayPal could do is not charge fees on like something like this. Wouldn't that be really cool?
That would be really cool.
I don't know if that
could go fund.
Are you listening, PayPal?
Ah, yeah. All right. You guys want to break this down?
Yeah. So what we like to do, Marcus, is to laugh out. So you can join us with laughing out. Before we do that, I'd just like to recap quickly that what we've been talking about here is how success is really about what we can give and what we can create and what we can produce rather than what we get. And if we do that in a happy way, we are much more productive, much more successful, and much more creative. So it's always my pleasure to help everybody live the happy life. If you want to know more, you can look for my book, Happiness Works. Get yours here. It's available at all the online stores, and we'll look forward to seeing you on Monday. Hey, okay. Take care, stay well, have fun. I'm Stephen Whiteley.
I'm over there on the phone. Thank you.
All right. Nice meeting you guys.
Thank you, Marcus.
You guys take care.
Thank you, Marcus.